In 1 Corinthians 14, starting verse 1, it says very clearly that we are to pursue love and desire spiritual gifts, especially prophecy. You know, it's amazing because that word desire comes from the Greek word zelo, which means to ardently go after or pursue with great intensity, to really eagerly want spiritual gifts, especially prophecy. So it's an incredible exhortation that we're told to go after this thing. Now, there's so much of the Bible. Did you know that 40% of your Bible is prophecy? Like, that's a lot. 40%, like either dreams, visions, 300 prophecies about Jesus's first coming from the Old Testament, which was all fulfilled, of course. And then there's more than 8 times that. There's about 2,400 different verses or 150 chapters that talk about his second coming, like he's coming again. And so this is prophecy as well as, you know, just encounters of people. So God really honors and cares and loves prophecy. Now we see that in the Old Testament, there was a select few. They were prophets. They were God's representatives, God's spokespeople on the earth. But things changed really in the New Testament, where we see that veil was torn from top to bottom when Jesus died on the cross. And that meant access. That meant access into this Holy of Holies. That meant access to hearing God. You know, the Joel 2, Acts 2, that in the last days, as the Lord prophesied, you know, this is that which is prophesied, that his spirit would be poured out in all flesh. Sons and daughters will prophesy. Men will dream dreams, see visions. So we're really in an escalated time of prophecy, where that very prophecy about in the last days, I'm going to pour out my spirit of prophecy, that there's more and more. Like when I was a kid, you didn't hear hardly anybody that did prophecy or knew prophecy or was a prophetic person. But now it's much more common. It's only going to continue to increase that we can hear God. Now, there's more to say about that. But basically, let's say this, must be biblical. Okay. Anything that's really God, truly from the source of the Lord, does not contradict the scriptures. It is consistent with the scriptures. Anything that truly is from God is also according to the love nature of God, because God is love. Anything that's from God is also going to be, as far as the gift of prophecy goes, that's recorded about in 1 Corinthians 14, edifying, encouraging, and exhorting. So somebody that's coming under prophecy or a gift of prophecy, there's exhortation to it. There's a building up and encouraging. Confirmation is important. Like, God's not going to just give you one dream that you've got to act on it without any confirmation. Like, confirmation from other people who hear God, confirmation from circumstances or the peace in your own heart or what other people confirm to you. And God also says this in Revelation 19, he says that the spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Jesus, which really is the words of Jesus or the witness of Jesus or, you know, his word. So anything, again, that's true prophecy is consistent with the witness of the ways of Jesus. And I'll also include this, that in John 16, it says in verse 12, it talks about Jesus is saying, he, the Spirit of truth, is coming, the Holy Spirit is coming. And whatever he says to you, he's going to disclose to you or tell you the things that the Father and the Son are saying. So in other words, technically it's the Holy Spirit who speaks to us in this whole area of prophecy. And therefore the fruit of the Spirit is present. When the Spirit is speaking, the fruit is present. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. So that's all evident in prophecy. So there's a lot of Bible pertaining to prophecy. Can't just throw that out. You know, we need to uncover this. I'm going to give one last verse. It's Proverbs 14:4, which says, when the ox is in the stall, basically there's a bit of a mess, but you have the strength of the increase that the ox brings. That's Proverbs 14, verse 4. And I liken that to prophecy. When prophecy is in your life, when prophecy is in your church, when prophecy is in your ministry, it's like having the ox there, as in the strength that would bring. It also means sometimes it's a bit of a mess, like as in you have to pastor it in your church, you have to judge it, you have to help those that are growing in prophecy and not just say, hey, that's a false prophet. A false prophet will be somebody who has a different intention altogether. But there's the immature prophets or the immature prophetic voices that they're just trying, you know, and they, you know, it's why we're called to pursue this. So in other words, embrace it, take the strength from it, and then also pastor it and judge it and, you know, all the things that God says for us to do with prophecy, but by certainly don't despise prophecies, 1 Thessalonians 5, and don't shut down the Spirit, or don't quench the Spirit. So quenching the Spirit can look like quenching prophecy, so we want to let the Spirit speak. Amen.